Well, thank you so much, Tudor, for the kind introduction and the invitation. I'm also kind of struggling. It's just kind of horrifying seeing what's going on and feeling very powerless and not sure what to do. But so I apologize if I'm a little distracted or out of it, but I'm just going to kind of go through with my plans to talk here about cultural evolution music. And I was, of course, really pleased that this was one of the themes that was being discussed at this symposium, because it's something that has been a big interest to me, but I think has been understudied in our field. So great to see the excitement for it here. And in particular, I'm a bit biased because I really like cultural evolution, but I think it's cultural evolution kind of holds the key to the other themes that we're discussing at this conference. So prediction and creativity, you can kind of think of prediction as sort of the stability of the transmission, and the creativity is more the diversity of the variation. And cultural evolution is sort of a theory that ties together the stability and variation in one kind of thing. So I'll try to talk about that today and how this kind of fits in the broader theme of this symposium, including the combining the sciences and the humanities. and on that topic, I think it's really great that this idea, you've got three themes and each one has two keynotes, one coming from the sciences, one from the humanities. At the same time, I think probably for most of us, it's not so much of a binary, it's more of a continuum. Like, I guess I'm a scientist here, and Gary Tomlinson will be the humanist. But my PhD is in ethnomusicology. I've done, of course, I play a lot of music, and I did my BA in music composition, where I wrote this nice, I really had fun doing this piece about based on Calvin and Hobbes comics. So I think we all, as I think Freya was saying yesterday, we wear many hats. Peter Vuost is a musician as well as a neuroscientist, and I think we're all somewhere on this continuum. We're in multiple places on the continuum. But I do think of all these, I'm probably most aligned with sort of the science side. So I'm happy to present kind of a scientist's view, and look forward to hearing Gary Tomlinson's view later on, and then talking at the roundtable with him and the rest of you about this topic. So just to start off, I want to talk about this paradox that Darwin proposed, and I think is still driving a lot of the research that we're doing here on music and evolution. So I'm sure many of you have ever heard this quote before, but I'll just read it out in full. So Darwin wrote in The Descent of Man, "As neither the enjoyment nor the capacity of producing musical notes are faculties of the least use to man in reference to his daily habits of life, they must be ranked among the most mysterious with which he is endowed. They're present in men of all races, but so different is the taste of the several races that our music gives no pleasure to savages, and their music is to us, in most cases, hideous and unmeaning." So, as a savage myself, kind of think that the language could be updated a little bit for our modern times. But I think the ideas are really timeless, still with us. And music seems useless, and yet it's universal. And yet it's also really diverse. And so, why is this? And what I want to argue is that cultural evolution is really key to understanding this universality and diversity. A sort of missing piece of the puzzle for our field. So today, I will touch a little bit on the sort of biological evolution idea that we're discussing, gene culture coevolution and universals, but I won't spend too much time on that. I gave a keynote last month at the Social Bridges Conference that was more about the biological side of things. So if you want to check that out, it's up on YouTube. But I'm going to focus today on this cultural evolution side that I think has been less well studied in our field. And I'll spend a bit of time on both the theoretical side and the empirical side and try to review a bunch of studies showing different ways that we can try to understand and study cultural evolution of music in a sort of empirical scientific perspective. But then I want to finish on sort of the broader question of, where do we go with this in terms of making the field more inclusive, more multidisciplinary, and a better field. So, to sort of quickly recap the whole biological side of things, the question of music and evolution has been with us for over 100 years, and started off with the interest of the early comparative musicologists like Karl Stumpf, who you can see here, and then kind of waned during the 20th century for a variety of reasons, and then really kind of got back into gear around the turn of the 21st century. Now coming more often from the psychology and biological side. So this edited volume by Niels Wallin, Björn Mücker, and Stephen Brown was a very kind of landmark publication to kick things off. And then more recently, Henk Jan Hoining edited a big collection that sort of has sort of the more recent update to the biological side of things. And there's been a few high-profile articles recently in, high-impact journals getting press coverage and, fancy media places. So some by my team, Josh McDonough's team, Sam Mayer's team, and the same kinds of, Darwin's paradoxes there you can see in most of the titles, right? Statistical universals, universality and diversity, cultural variation, trying to understand this sort of this dual universality and diversity of human music around the world. And then, as Tudor mentioned, we had this really, I think, productive, fascinating exchange in the Journal of Behavioral and Brain Sciences. So my team proposed a sort of gene culture coevolutionary theory about music and social bonding. Sam Mayer's team proposed a sort of alternative theory about signaling. And then we had 109 different experts kind of all weighing in on both of these and their own thoughts about it. And I think the main take home from it all is that there's still a lot of room for debate. We really, 150 years later, haven't really answered Darwin's paradox. So this was a survey that Henk Jan Hoining and Bas Cornelissen put together, asking the commentators to rate, how much they supported the social bonding theory on the x-axis versus the credible signaling theory on the y-axis. And it's kind of all over the place. And I just kind of got a few sort of somewhat representative pictures of the different scholars, and you can see, the kind of who's who of the field of music cognition scattered all across the map. So there's still a lot of room for debate, and a lot of productive area to be discovered here. But one thing that I think most of us agreed on, including I think it was pretty clearly made in both target articles, was that cultural evolution is playing a key role in the process, but we still don't really know exactly what their role is. So we kind of both articles kind of left cultural evolution for like this is really important, but we don't have a lot of evidence, so it needs to be looked at next. And so that is what I want to spend most of today's talk talking about, what evidence we do have, and even better, what evidence we could try to get in the future. Now we can try to look at this going forward. So on to the main topic. So most of my talk, I'm going to be building a bit on some reviews that I and others have written on the topic. And there's two in particular. So one's kind of a more theoretical one that I published in 2019, which is really focused at musicologists, in particular ethnomusicologists, who may be quite skeptical of this idea of cultural evolution. And then the other one is more empirical, and it's appearing in this Oxford Handbook of Cultural Evolution. So it's kind of opposite. It's not trying to convince skeptical musicologists, but it's trying to convince cultural evolutionary scientists who are really already on board with the idea of cultural evolution about why music should matter to them, and what kind of interesting insights can be had from this scientific study of musical evolution. And this was led by Mason Youngblood, and also in collaboration with my PhD student Yuta Ozaki. So I think these two not only will help structure the talk, but it's kind of a nice, it matches the theme of the conference, kind of trying to synthesize the humanities and the sciences approaches to these issues. So I'm going to start with the theory side. And the first question is, what do we mean by evolution? So a lot of people think that evolution has something to do with progress or something to do with genes or both. But actually, if you look at the definitions that have come up through the years, they don't necessarily feature in them. So Darwin, he didn't even know about genes at the time, and he didn't talk about progress. Instead, he referred to evolution as descent with modification, right? So sharing descent, but it's being modified as you go and diversify. A more recent definition that I particularly like is by Denshin et al. And they talk about the process by which the frequencies of variance in a population change over time. And it's important to realize they don't say frequencies of genes, they say variance. And they explicitly say that cultural variants also count as evolution. If you have cultural variants that are changing over time, the frequencies, that's evolution. So rather than genes or progress, there's three main mechanisms that tend to be focused on in studies of evolution. And those are transmission, variation, and selection. And actually, these are all present in this really kind of ahead of its time definition published by the International Folk Music Council about 70 years ago. So it's a definition of folk music, and they say folk music is a product of a musical tradition that has been evolved through the process of oral transmission. Factors that shape the tradition are 1, continuity, which links the present with the past, 2, variation, which springs from the creative impulses of the individual or the group, and 3, selection by the community, which determines the form or forms in which the music survives. So not only does this get these three sort of transmission, variation, and selection ideas, I think it all, as I was mentioning, it also touches on this ideas about prediction and creativity, right? So the continuity, the stability there is giving you the predictability, but then the variation, which springs from the creative impulse of the individual, the group, so that's where the creativity comes in. And then you could sort of think of the selection factor as being sort of the third prong in this confluence, where the forces that shape the evolution. It could be neutral, but it could also be directional, evolve in certain directions more than others because of the way that our brains process music, or the way that our vocal systems are able to sing, or how we play instruments, or whatever. So again, I was kind of struck that this kind of very rigorous parallels with biological evolution were being talked about 70 years ago. Now, unfortunately, this is more the exception than the rule. So a lot of the early research on culture evolution music did have this sort of Spencerian progressive ideas about music evolving from, primitive music of hunter-gatherers to the complex, sophisticated music of, the German classical masters who, I think it was this school kind of developed in Germany, and there was definitely a sort of a bias towards trying to say, why our music is so great. And so just a couple of quotes to show you what I'm talking about. So Karl Stumpf, in his book, The Origins of Music, which was, as I mentioned, was kind of a landmark, he writes, "The most primitive songs, e.g. those of the Veda of Ceylon, one may label them as mere preliminary stages or even as the origins of music." Kurt Zachs, 1943, wrote of the plain truth that the sing-song of pygmies and pygmoids stands infinitely closer to the beginnings of music than Beethoven's symphonies and Schubert's Lieder. The only working hypothesis admissible is that the earliest music must be found among the most primitive peoples. And then, as recently as 1976, Alan Lomax was writing about the pygmies being living representatives of early man. And as Tudor mentioned, I'm a huge admirer of Alan Lomax's work, very much inspired by it. But I think this kind of way of thinking about hunter-gatherers as, living fossils, is not only sort of racist and offensive, but is sort of evolutionarily wrong. These people and their cultures did not stop, 200,000 years ago or whatever. They've been evolving in different directions, which are not necessarily any better or worse than the directions that other music has evolved in. And I think, that evolution biologists and cultural evolutionists have generally rejected this idea about assuming that things go from simple to complex, or that progress is an inevitable part of evolution. But a lot of ethnomusicologists still seem to think that when I say cultural evolution music, I'm talking about this kind of thing. So that's definitely not the case. So I try to make it very clear in this review that we're talking about evolution. We're not talking about this march of progress, which would be ridiculous to go from, if the mandolin is the height of progress, that would be ridiculous anyway. But just the whole concept is just, it's just wrong. But I think this sort of history legacy of racism and colonialism, and the sort of negative associations with cultural evolution, still remains kind of a barrier to this interdisciplinary study of cultural evolution of music. And I think it's a big challenge for us to get over people's resistance to this idea of cultural evolution. And I wanted to mention that Gary Tomlinson is one of the few kind of humanities scholars who's really, from quite early on, been pushing the importance of cultural evolution in its more sophisticated, modern, I would say, more correct form. And so I'm really pleased that he's going to be giving the next keynote, and I look forward to discussing and hearing his talk and discussing this idea with him. And if you haven't seen it, his 2015 book about a million years of music is a really fantastic discussion of some of these issues. So If evolution is not about progress, what is it about? It's really more about the diversification, and rather than a linear march of progress, this idea about branching phylogenetic trees, like family trees, is really crucial to Darwin's original idea and also to most mainstream cultural evolutionary work. So this is a very famous diagram drawn by Darwin in the original notes about evolution. So he says, "I think," and then he draws this tree. So here would be the common ancestor of all these different species, and then it kind of diversifies, branches off, some lineages die off, others survive and keep diversifying and to give us these different species that we see today. But even back 150 years ago, Darwin was saying this is not just a process that has to do with biological species, but it applies to culture and it applies to language. So here's another great quote from Darwin: "The formation of different languages and of distinct species, and the proofs that both have been developed through a gradual process are curiously parallel." And recently there's been a real boom in language evolution studies, and I think of all the fields of cultural evolution, that may be where we have some of the best evidence for a clear evolutionary process shaping the languages that we speak today. So here's a nice study by Russell Gray's team, where they applied phylogenetic methods to reconstruct a family tree of the Austronesian languages, which are spoken throughout the Pacific, and expanded over the past 5,000 or so years. And you can actually reconstruct the timing and the trajectory of the expansion through the similarities and differences that have developed in the languages between, different Polynesian languages, Māori and Hawaiian and things like that, and then going all the way back to Taiwan. I've been to Taiwan and to talk with some of the indigenous people, and the Māori counting words that I learned growing up in New Zealand, some of them are very, very similar to the ones that they have counting in Taiwan. So you can trace these the similarities and differences through the evolutionary methods. It works particularly well in a place like the Pacific, where humans were expanding into areas that were previously unoccupied, and then they become kind of separated by ocean. So there's not so much kind of cross contact between cultures. It gets more complicated when you have different groups kind of layering over each other, but the same principles still apply. So I've been very inspired by the language evolution research, and in my review article, I tried to point out some of the possible parallels between music and language and genes. I won't go through them all here, but just a couple parallels are, genes. We have the units can be things like amino acids or genes. In language, they could be maybe phonemes or words. In music, we can have notes or phrases. In biology, we have fossils. In language, we have ancient texts. And in music, we can have ancient notation. We can have audio or video recordings to reconstruct things over time. We have, language families or homologies in biology, and in music we can have things like tune families. And there's actually a lot of research on this in folk song studies on tune families, but it hasn't really been so connected to the broader cultural evolution literature. And this kind of gets us in. So Tecumseh Fitch, when he introduced this conference, he mentioned the idea of music and mimetics. And his recent commentary on this. So, if for those of you who don't know, the idea of a meme was originally proposed by Richard Dawkins as a unit of cultural transmission analogous to a gene. And actually, music was his first example. He said examples of memes are tunes, ideas, catchphrases, clothes, fashions, ways of making pots or building hutches. And ironically, the idea of a meme has itself evolved to mean something different from what Dawkins meant. It's more of an internet meme now. The idea of a unit of cultural evolution has been a bit controversial, but so in their commentary on our paper that we have just out in Current Biology, Tecumseh and Marissa Heschel kind of revive this idea, and they point out the analogies that we study between sort of sequences of genes and sequences of musical notes, the way you can have substitutions or insertions or deletions, and certain kinds of changes are more likely than others. But sometimes, one of the critics of mimetics is that they focus too much on the similarities and not enough on the differences. But sometimes it's the differences that can be most interesting. Like one thing we show is that in music, actually, substitutions, sorry, insertions and deletions are more common than substitutions, whereas the reverse is true in genetics. And this is because you can add or delete a note in music, and you can just kind of make the note longer or shorter and not mess with the meter. Whereas in genetics, if you add, a nucleotide, you completely throw off this three note or three letter code, and you start making completely different amino acids. So the mechanisms can be quite different, but the processes can be sort of analogous. All right, just before I wrap up the sort of theoretical stuff and get more to the empirical stuff, I do want to bring back this role of complexity. So I tried to make it pretty clear that, you know, this assumption that evolution is necessarily involves progress from simple to complex is kind of outdated and wrong. But maybe it's a little more complicated because there have been some recent, recently the idea of cumulative cultural evolution has been kind of a hot topic. So we shouldn't make the assumption that things necessarily evolve from simple to complex, and that we can assume that simple cultures had simple music or whatever. But whether this is sort of a general trend or not is actually kind of up for debate. And this paper just came out a couple weeks ago, and I think Tecumseh mentioned it in his introduction, so I thought I would bring it back here that there is some debate about does music or does not actually accumulate complexity over time. And actually, this paper, I think they argue that it doesn't necessarily, and that aesthetic things like music may be fundamentally different from technological things, where technology, the whole point is to accumulate better and better tools. In aesthetics, it might not really be about better and better or more complex. It might be a different process going on. So this is, I think, up for debate as one of the questions that we can look at going forward. All right, so moving from this theory to more the empirical side, I just want to show, you know, I can't show all the studies that have been published, even though it's a young field, there's still already quite a good amount of work going on. But I want to highlight a few of what I think are some of the more exciting studies that show us where we can go from here. And again, this is drawing on our review by Mason and Yuto. And this figure comes from the review, and we kind of divide these into different ways of looking at musical evolution. You can look at the notes, either from you know, the sound itself, either in notated or in audio form. You can look at the interactions between musicians, artist networks. You can look at the way that things are transmitted from like one brain to the next brain. Or you can look at things like instruments or even social contexts. So let's look how we can do this. I'll spend a little bit of time introducing the details of this study that I mentioned just came out in Current Biology, because it's really trying to get at the really micro level of these analogies and really show that music really is literally evolving in the folk songs we sing around us. So I'll spend a couple of slides on these methods, and then I'll kind of breeze through a bunch of other studies to give you some ideas. So the basic method we're looking at is the sequence alignment approach, and really taking the analogy quite seriously and saying, well, if we can model genetic sequences as, you know, sequences of nucleotides or amino acids that are labeled C, G, D, or whatever, we can do the same thing with music. You know, a melody can be represented, simplified representation as a sequence of letters, C's and G's and D's. And we can kind of align different melodies and say, okay, where are they similar? Where are they different? And we can count and kind of quantify the similarity. We can count, you know, where and why do these similarities occur? And we can say, are there any general rules that might shape this, not just, you know, in one genre, but that can be kind of cross-culturally general. So here's an example of how we do this with a kind of well-known English folk song, Scarborough Fair. I'm sure that many of you have heard it before, at least Simon and Garfunkel's version. But you may not have heard Martin Carthy's version, which he taught to Paul Simon and recorded a year before they did. And if you listen now, you can see it's slightly different. So I'll play it to here, and hopefully the sound will come through.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme.
Okay, now let's listen to Simon and Garfunkel's version.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and
Okay, so you may have heard there that was a couple of notes were different. So these red ones here were slightly different. So instead of to Scarborough Fair, Paul Simon and Garfunkel sing to Scarborough Fair. It's a very small change, just a minor second or a major second here, hardly noticeable. But it's a sort of a substitution of a note there. And then later on, you have this sort of deletion of these ornamental notes. Parsley, sage becomes just parsley, sage. And these two ornamental notes are deleted. And this kind of gives us, you know, fits with the idea we're talking about, that smaller changes to the melody are more likely to occur. So, you know, it'd be very unlikely to sort of say, parsley, sage, rosemary, and just delete the final note, right? It's a very important note. Whereas it's much more likely to kind of delete some of these ornamental notes. Or the changes, you're much more likely to have a small change like to Scarborough Fair than are you going to Scarborough Fair, right? You're going to have small changes in melody are going to be more noticeable and feel more, you know, harder to do and just generally less likely. And so we can quantify this and sort of say, you know, we can test this in other repertoires. So here are some Japanese folk songs. One particular folk song called Itsuki no Komori Uta, which is a lullaby. This is some old notations recorded about 100 years ago without audio recordings. But you can listen to me singing, just by pure coincidence, I was singing the song to my colleague Shinya Fuji's baby, and he fell asleep just as I was singing the section that we had transcribed for the paper. Just perfect coincidence. So I want you to listen to the power of this lullaby. He's totally out. So really showing the power of music there. But also, if you're listening to the melody and following along, you might have noticed my version is slightly different from what you have here. And the changes that I sang were, again, kind of small ornamental changes, especially in the section here where there's lots of ornamentation. Just kind of mess around with it. I wouldn't change the final note. So, you know, similar kinds of principles happen in these very different repertoires. So these are sort of anecdotal examples. It's easy to find anecdotes that support your ideas, but there may well be some, you know, counterexamples. So we wanted to test this in a quite rigorous sort of larger sample in kind of a you know, more scientific way. And we particularly wanted to look at these repertoires because they've been really well studied. So these English folk songs were a big focus of this whole kind of folk revival movement. People like Cecil Sharp, Bertrand Bronson spent lifetimes, you know, tracking down all the versions and variants of these child ballads. And actually, this similar thing was happening in Japan. So people like Kasho Machida, you know, he mobilized teams to go throughout Japan, recording thousands of songs from every prefecture in Japan, writing them down in Western notation and trying to trace their evolution. So all these scholars, you know, spent, you know, their lifetimes recording this stuff, but they never really kind of synthesized it in a kind of using kind of modern evolutionary methods. So it was kind of low-hanging fruit. We you know, put together these notation they had compiled. I spent a few hundred hours or so going back through them and convert them all into aligned sequences that would, you know, we could use these automated algorithms with. We ran them through the algorithms, calculated all the similarities, and identified only those ones that were really highly similar. So 85% similar more, so we really knew they were like definitely shared the same ancestry. And then we checked, so where do the changes tend to happen? And what changes do we tend to find? And so first we confirmed what we kind of knew going in, which was that they were quite different in many ways, especially the scales. Yes, there were a couple of scales that were overlapped, but most of them did not. So the red ones here overlapped. Non-red ones were differed between the two samples. Japanese ones tended to be pentatonic, like the one you just heard. The English ones tended to be more heptatonic, you know, seven notes, like the standard major scale that you are probably familiar with. So lots of differences in the tonal structure and the melodies. They're completely different repertoires. And yet these two principles, we found quite similar patterns. So the notes with stronger rhythmic function tend to be much more stable than the ones with the weak rhythmic functions in both English and Japanese. And when we did get substitutions, they overwhelmingly tended to be small melodic distances of seconds or thirds, rather than, you know, sixths or sevenths. This is very consistent across both samples. So confirming our predictions that these similar sort of evolutionary forces were operating on these different repertoires. So very different scales and music, but the same kind of evolutionary processes can be governing their evolution. So hopefully this is kind of convincing that evolution methods can be applied to real life music in different cultures, and the same kinds of principles can apply. But it's not just limited to these kind of very restricted, you know, very similar folk song contexts. We can also apply these to very different contexts, like contexts such as pop music copyright disputes. So the same kind of alignment, similarity calculations can help us out with, you know, there's a famous case here where George Harrison from the Beatles was found liable for infringing the chiffon's copyright. And if we align those melodies that they use in the actual court case, and we kind of apply these methods, we can see, yeah, they're pretty similar. Not identical, but 64% identical notes. I'll play through the sound so you can hear what's going on.
He's so fine.
This is just a short excerpt. It's actually, the chorus is also quite similar too, but just playing this part.
My sweet Lord, my Lord, my Lord.
All right, so this, you know, is never gonna, you know, there's a lot of other factors at play in here. So I would never want this method to kind of replace subjective methods. But it can help when you have, you know, these trials where one expert will say these, you know, hired by one team will say these are completely identical, and the other expert will say these are completely different, and you don't know who to believe. So we've applied this method to samples of past copyright decisions and found that it predicts surprisingly well, like 70 or more percent of cases. The sort of 50% similar seems to be kind of a rough guide to what you can expect before it becomes too close for the courts. And some work done by my graduate student Yuchen Yuan. We're also doing some perceptual experiments on this question. But certainly doesn't have to be restricted to folk music. Sorry. Another very different repertoire that similar method can apply to is Japanese gaoku. So this is a ritual art music played for kind of serious imperial rituals in Japan. And actually has the sort of longest documented, notated history of any orchestral music. It goes back continuously from now back to, you know, over 1,000 years. So this is an example that Alan Merritt had previously analyzed. I just kind of adapted his to fit my notation method. But looking at the evolution of a score from 10th century through the 14th to the 20th century, and you can see that there's just been so many insertions. All these notes have been added, and you can kind of quantify and see just this massive kind of evolution going on here. And so accompanying this, that the music has slowed down enormously, so much that what was used to be the original melody here has become kind of this vestigial kind of Schenkerian kind of background that you can't even really hear anymore. But it's still there. And so this is, I think, a really fascinating example of a very different kind of deeper kind of evolutionary process that's shaping the real music that we listen to today. And so interestingly enough, this kind of came from originally from Tang Dynasty China, but it died out and became extinct in China, but it kind of adapted to its new context in Japan and became the ultimate Japanese music, the music of the Emperor of Japan. Another interesting thing, so I was saying that, you know, we don't tend to have sort of simple to complex necessarily, but in this case, it does seem like you're having an accumulation of more and more complex music, more and more notes over time. So perhaps this could be an example of a cumulative cultural evolution. And I'm not a Gregorian chant scholar, so I don't know really if this is true, but I've heard people say that a similar process has been going on in Gregorian chant, sort of the cantus firmus being elaborated on, becoming more complex and enumerated over time. It'd be really fascinating, I think, to do a comparative study there. In fact, I know some people are trying to do this, and I look forward to more of this kind of work. Okay, so I kind of started on ones that I'm more close to my heart. I love Japanese folk song and English folk song, and I live in Japan, so Japanese music is good. I'm actually less familiar with the Western classical music. I know many of you are more expert at that, but similar methods have been applied to notation in Western classical music, which has the benefit of a really rich documented notated history over many centuries. And so one analysis here kind of reconstructed what I think most people take for granted, but is often not necessarily backed by scientific evidence that sort of the common practice Western classical music can kind of be grouped into these four main periods that sort of rose and fall. So the Baroque going to the classical to the Romantic and then 20th century. And so these kinds of methods can sometimes help us to confirm what we already know, or they can sometimes be surprising and find differences that we didn't expect to find there. I will kind of shoot through more of these studies. I won't spend a lot of time on the methods, but it doesn't just work with notation. You can look at audio. So Matthias Mauch and colleagues did applied music information retrieval methods to the audio recordings of pop charts over about 50 years. And you can kind of trace the rise and fall of these different genres. So you can see up here, hip hop kind of busting onto the scene literally in the 1980s and 1990s and really dominating, whereas other genres, kind of like funk and jazz, sort of being strong earlier on and kind of dying out over the course of the 20th, second half of the 20th century. Just really cool to see these methods can be help us look at the really big picture about changes in music over time. And even bigger picture, perhaps. So Alan Lomax's work I mentioned being a big inspiration. So he has this cantometrics data set that he collected of about 6,000 songs from almost 1,000 cultures that you see here of traditional folk music. As Tudor mentioned, so I've been working with Alan's daughter Anna Lomax Wood and many others to kind of digitize and get that available. So if any of you want to take a look at it, it's already out there. You can download it, you can play with it, you can analyze it. You can also listen to all the music, or almost all the music, at theglobaljukebox.org. So it's just a beautiful resource for listening, if even if you don't want to get into the science. But Lomax was very interested in the evolution as well. As he was a folk song collector, he was a musician, but he was also a scientist, and he believed that these all kind of share this cultural evolutionary history, and he proposed this kind of tree of song style with 10 major styles that were quite complexly related to each other. So we had said there was two different roots, there was some blending between the branches, and so he proposed this sort of tree, which has not really been, I think, verified. It was more a little bit more hypothetical. So would love to see people test this in a more rigorous way with the data that's now available. Sorry, my kids, it sounds like they're whacking each other or something. Hopefully my wife will be able to handle it. Moving on to other domains. So not just the sounds of songs that is kind of I particularly like, but the actual physical materials, the instruments can also evolve, and we can trace that. So Ilya Temkin and colleagues looked at the evolution of different instruments, including the cornet. And again, we have some nice time-resolved data, so we can actually trace it from the 1800s through the late 1900s, and you can see where these different innovations in things like the valves and the bell happened through time. And again, you can find these kind of interesting connections where these lineages will kind of cross-pollinate. So you get kind of horizontal transmission between the lineages, which makes cultural evolution so interesting. Another thing we can look at is not the music instruments or the sound itself, but the musicians. So how do they work together? So this was some work with Mason Youngblood and Karim Baragif, and they looked here at collaboration networks of artists in electronic music through the 1970s to the end of the 20th century. And so based on who collaborates with who, so here's one record of these three musicians collaborating on a different one, they'll collaborate with different people. And you could use those networks to reconstruct the sort of networks and the evolution of these different styles over time. And so again, we're creating a sort of a phylogenetic tree, but it's a complex one that kind of crosses with horizontal transmission between the branches. So you have, this yellow, trance emerging here, and different genres like hardcore and disco. But there's a lot of interconnection. These they're all influencing each other, and yet also evolving in distinct directions. So I think a really useful way of looking at the big picture patterns in cultural evolution. All right, so up to now this has mostly kind of been corpus studies, real music that's been made in the real world, where we're kind of analyzing corpuses. But you can also look at these things in a more controlled experimental way. So there's this really cool experiment called Darwin Tunes by Bob McCullum and colleagues, where they did just this. And they kind of made this cool audio, very short summary with musical examples to accompany their paper. So I'll just let them explain it. I'll let Bob explain it in his own words. This is about a minute or two.
Hi, this is Dr. Bob McCallum from Imperial College London, and I'm going to talk you through the Darwin Tunes Evolutionary Music Experiment, featured in the PNAS article entitled Evolution of Music by Public Choice. In Darwin Tunes, a population of short musical loops evolves as web-based listeners rate them on a scale of 1 to 5. The higher-rated loops get to have sex and make baby loops, which form the next generation, which are rated, have sex, make babies, and so on. This sexual reproduction, combined with a low level of mutation, provides the variation required for Darwinian evolution. The experiment starts with loops where the notes and sounds are randomly assigned by the computer. The sounds are built purely from combinations of sinusoidal waveforms. They sound pretty awful, and these were some of the better examples. After 150 generations, which equates to 3,000 loops having been auditioned, there is a more steady rhythm, but the sound still has some rough edges. After 500 generations, the sounds are more pleasant and there is some simple major chord harmony. After 1,000 generations, very simple melodies are starting to appear, while the sound textures are getting more complex. At 2,000 generations, not that much has changed in terms of musicality, but there are some new sounds and a new short melodic element is present. Finally, at over 3,000 generations, there are some quite complex intertwining melodies with rhythmic accompaniment, and even a kick drum sound has emerged. Listen out for it. You can take part and evolve the music even further by visiting darwintunes.org. Thanks for listening.
All right, so this is a kind of another quite different way of looking at things, which I think is quite quite cool. This one is really focusing just on. Sort of selection, the perception side, just listeners selecting, not making music. But of course, those of us who like to make music maybe want to know more about the production side of things. And so there's another series of studies that look at that from a kind of different production-based angle. So one by Andrea Ravignani and colleagues did these transmission experiments, so kind of like the children's game telephone, where you sort of one person whispers into another's ear, and then they have to whisper that phrase into another person's ear, and it goes on down the chain, and it tends to change in kind of sometimes funny ways. So they do basically the same thing in the lab, but with rhythmic patterns here. And one person has to try to hear that and then reproduce it, and then that is passed on to the next drummer who hears it and reproduces it, and so on. What you find is if you start with purely random rhythmic patterns, It'll kind of evolve more predictability and go towards these sort of these biases we have towards, simple integer ratios, regular rhythmic patterns, sort of suggesting that maybe sort of a kind of a innate or a pre-existing disposition to those. So those, of course, if you do it just with Western listeners, you can't tell whether this is really kind of innate or universal or just sort of due to experience with Western music. But a number of other studies have looked at similar things, like Nora Jacoby and colleagues did something very similar. It came out the exact same week, conversion evolution of good ideas. But they did basically the same kind of paradigm, although it was just within one listener who listens themselves and then repeats it and goes on. But they did it in two different cultures. They did it in the Tsimane people in the Amazon, who are very isolated from Western music, and found very similar, well, not identical patterns, but similar preferences for integer ratios. People have also looked at this not just with rhythm, but with melody. So Massimo Dimacca, who I believe gave the workshop the other night, has done this with melodies. And then Nori and many of us have recently replicated this stuff with a global study, which I'll maybe discuss a little bit later on. So there's quite a lot of productive stuff happening here. And you're in luck, because if you want to know more about this, Helena Miton has done other cool studies on this, and she's going to be giving a workshop on this very topic in just a few hours. So she can tell you all about how this is done and give you some practical tips on how to do it. And finally, this has been all kind of just to focus on the music itself, but we can also look beyond music and say, how is cultural evolution of music related to other things in human evolution, language or genes? So this is actually how I got started in my very first research as a master's student with Stephen Brown. We wanted to say, can music be used to sort of study human migrations the way that genes or languages can? And we were looking at kind of quite focused study on the different diversity within Taiwan, and the indigenous populations there, comparing musical, genetic, and linguistic diversity. We found sort of significant correlations between musical and genetic diversity, but not with language. But then I continued doing this in my studies in Japan, and I worked with Hiromi Matsumae and Peter Rancher and many others on a little bit broader sample of 14 populations from down Northeast Asia. But we kind of found somewhat opposite things. So here, language was predicting genes, but not music. And so we thought, what's going on? And we really needed a global sample. And thankfully, because of all the work we did getting the Global Jukebox published, now we did have a global sample. And so Sam Passmore, my postdoc, has been working on these analyses. We're hoping to post a preprint any day now or any week now. And we're looking at same kinds of analyses, but now on the scale of, over 120 populations throughout the world. And quite surprisingly to me, our predictions were not really very supported. So music, we kind of thought music and genes and language would be quite correlated, and would be tracking similar patterns throughout the world. And they were significantly correlated, but it was pretty weak. All the correlations between genes and culture, so genes and music, genes and language, music and language, they're all like R equals 0.2-ish. It's like accounting for less than 10% of all the variants. The only thing that had a really strong relationship was genes and geography, which is very much stronger. R equals 0.7 something, accounting for more than 50% of the variants in one variable. So this kind of made me think that actually many of the critics, or our critics, were right. They say, music is independent of genes. It's independent of language. It's going to tell you something different. And so this is, I think, a good example where the science of music and diversity can, it doesn't necessarily support our predispositions. It can kind of prove us wrong, and it can support those who are kind of skeptical. So perhaps you're feeling a little bit overwhelmed with all the data. I'm feeling a little bit overwhelmed just talking through it with you. So I will leave it there, but hopefully you've just had a glimpse of the kinds of diverse things you can do with this cultural evolutionary method, and the things that have already been done and the things that still have yet to be done. But I would like to bring it back to the bigger questions about the symposium, right? So, collaboration, multidisciplinary collaboration, inclusive music and science. And I really think it's important to think about sort of the historical context. I think, right now we're seeing this historical beginnings of a new phase with the war, the pandemic era. Things are really changing dramatically, and one of the things that has been major has been this idea about diversity and inclusion. So in music studies and beyond, in academia, I think racism, colonialism, and kind of reckoning with our past. And I'm very aware that I've been trying to show you all the faces of the people doing these studies. I think it's important to see the human side, but a very large majority of them are people like me, white men. And I think that most of us recognize that that needs to change to make the field, be better and be all it can be. And so just a few things have been happening in the last couple of years. So debates about racism and music theory have, been on the pages of the New York Times and many other places, Fox News. The president of the Society for Ethnomusicology has resigned. International Council for Traditional Music has had this huge year-long series of 24 decolonization dialogues. We've seen anti-racism statements from the Board of Society for Music Perception and Cognition, critiques of, parachute science in music and anthropology and beyond. I think it's really kind of a reckoning for the way that we do our science and address diversity and inclusion. And, one of the big themes of this conference is interdisciplinary diversity, right? Humanities and science. And of course, I'm totally for that. And I've been arguing that for a while. But it's just that by itself is not enough. So, for example, a bunch of us got together a couple years ago at the Max Planck Institute for Empirical Aesthetics, bringing together ethnomusicologists, music cognition scientists, to try to kind of bridge some of these barriers, become more inclusive. But we sort of realized that the conference that we diversified in disciplinary ways, but in other ways, ethnicity, geography, sort of elite status, it wasn't so diverse. There was a lot of people from, elite universities in Europe and the East Coast in America, and it was not so diverse in other ways, and we needed to do better. Very similar things can be said for the music cognition societies. So this is a map from the Society for Music Perception and Cognition. See, heavily overrepresented in North America and Europe, a little bit in Asia, none in Africa. So it has quite a long way to go to become more diverse and inclusive. I should say, though, that it's getting better. So I just updated this slide today and was pleased to see. I used to say there was nothing in Latin America, but now there's at least three labs that appear. So things are improving a little bit, but we still have a long way to go. So one of the steps that some of us have tried to work on, so thinking about sort of the successes and failures of that, the previous workshop, so Nora Jacoby and Lisa Margulis, who organized the first one, and myself got together and tried to organize a follow-up that was a bit more kind of diverse geographically and a few other ways. And it ended up being on Zoom, of course, with the pandemic, but we had a really nice discussion with all these people here. And we came up with 14 principles to sort of try to make global collaborations more sustainable, more equitable. I won't go through them all now. You can always look at our preprints. But I will just highlight the one that we thought is kind of most important. Number one is trying to identify and recruit stakeholders representing diverse communities at all levels of organization and all stages of a project. So including different voices from different communities at the very beginning and at the higher levels is really crucial to getting kind of all the follow-up things. Now, I should say this is much easier said than done. So we haven't necessarily been able to do it as well as we'd like, but we're really trying to work on being better there. I would fully admit and agree that we haven't done enough so far. So Sarah Sauve and her colleagues have a critique that they recently posted to SciArchive that specifically addresses both of those papers I just mentioned, the music perception paper and the follow-up chapter, kind of saying, yes, it's going in the right direction, more diversity, but it's not nearly going far enough. It needs to not only kind of be assimilatory, have other people from other cultures become part of the scientific enterprise, but it needs to kind of radically reframe the viewpoint to be sort of less sort of Western colonial science focused and more anti-colonial. And I think I very much agree with the spirit. I'm not quite sure exactly how we can do this logistically, but I think I would love to discuss maybe in the Q&A and perhaps later on the roundtable. A few examples that I think are hopefully going in a more inclusive direction. I think Nora Jacoby has a study that I'm privileged to be involved in, where he's trying to do this. So working with researchers from these 15 different countries, many of whom are ethnomusicologists, many of whom are scientists, and really, it's really collaborative. And I think it's not only sort of more equitable, but also I think it's hard quality data. So you're really getting people who know the music and the culture, are invested in it, and recruiting, good samples. And in the interpretation, I think, is richer when you're involving people. So I think this is a great example of, not perfect by any means, but moving forward towards a little bit more inclusive collaborations. Now, this is very much scientist led. So Sarah and Sauve and colleagues might say it's still a colonial kind of science framework. This is another example of a project that's very unusual in that it's a big global mega collaboration, but it's led by ethnomusicologists. So led by Polina Protskova, who I see in the chat, or I see in the participants here. And she's got a bunch of researchers around the world transcribing songs from their own traditions that they're expert in, and trying to look and see how much people agree or disagree in the transcriptions, using computer-assisted but ultimately human-based judgments, and they're coming from a more subjective angle. I will skip playing this example here because I think I'm running out of time, but I think this is again, it's not perfect. It has its issues, like all research does, but I think it's a cool example of inclusive collaborations. And then finally, we're just starting one actually in my lab, and I would like to invite anyone who wants to be involved. And so really interested in this question of song and speech relationships. How does music and language differ around the world? What, if anything, is universal about, differences between song and speech? And we'd like to do this, collaborating with researchers who actually speak different languages as a native language and can sing and speak in these different languages. And I think will give us really good quality data, and will just be fun and really exciting to be involved in a big collaboration with people who really speak all these different languages, coming together to try to say how and why the music and language differ around the world. So if you're interested in that, please get in touch. We're just in the early phases. We'd love to involve as many people as possible. And especially if you're a non-English native speaker, doesn't have to be one of these languages, it can be any language. So I think these kinds of collaborative projects have a lot of potential to look at cultural evolution and diversity in music cognition in general. And of course, I've focused on ones that I've been involved in, but if you have other ones that you don't want me involved in, that's great. Please, I think this kind of collaborative global approach is gonna take us in good directions. So I'll wrap it up here. Thanks for your attention, but I know it's been a lot to take in, but if I want you to remember anything from this, two main points. One is that cultural evolution is really crucial to understanding this balance that we've been discussing at this symposium between prediction or universality and creativity and diversity in music cognition. And I think the way forward here is an inclusive, multidisciplinary global collaborations. And final thing before I finish, just want to make a quick shout out. If you want to come visit us in Japan, hopefully the pandemic will have calmed down next year. ICMPC will be in Tokyo in August, and I would love to see you here and share some sake and folk songs together. So just before I finish, I want to of course thank the organizers for inviting me. It's a real treat and privilege. Adrian and Christopher for technical support, my many collaborators who've contributed to the research, especially my students have done a lot of the hard work, funding agencies, and most especially my wife, who's been taking care of my kids and allowing me to talk to all you fine people. And of course, thanks to you for your attention. Thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions.